So, win states. I got a request to talk about them, or at least to go into more detail about what I meant by explicit versus implicit win states. And since I'm going to be insanely busy for personal reasons over the next few weeks, I figured a quick blip would be just what we needed. As usual, unless I reference a specific book or article, most of what I'm going to say is a combination of an ass pull and common sense. On one hand, games really don't have a great vocabulary and there's plenty of progress to be made, and on the other hand, you're listening to a random fat guy on the internet with a YouTube channel who hasn't made a video game in a very long time. So, much like the video on kinesthetics, nothing I say should be taken as gospel or any sort of accepted terminology or accredited thinking, but more of a springboard for discussions and design considerations. Like most tools at a designer's disposal, win states have several effects that you may want and several you may not. The biggest impact a win state has is to contextualize play. Now, when I say contextualize play, I mean that the events and actions in the system can be observed to have a value based on whether they help or hinder you get to the win state. Picture The Sims. Here's this big, complicated system full of things you can do, but each option seems as valid as any other. You can socialize, or you can keep your sim happy, or you can get rich, or you can fix up your house, but you can't really meaningfully compare and contrast them, and it's really up to the player to decide what they want to do. But what happens if, say, you won the game by getting 20 friends? Think of how that would fundamentally shape the way you thought of the different mechanics in the game, which ones were important and which ones weren't, or how you choose to spend your time. How does that compare to, say, a version of The Sims where you win by getting the highest possible promotion? And how would either of those play when stacked against a version of the game where you won by getting your home valued at over 100,000 simoleons? The power of win states is the power to shape player interaction with the system and drive them in specific directions you want to see the player go. But this play-shaping ability comes at a cost. Win states are so powerful when it comes to driving player motivation that any and all mechanics tend to be viewed through that lens. So tertiary and optional stuff becomes at best a distraction and at worst a detrimental activity that has no value. This means that if you do have a win state, most of your mechanics need to be somehow related. I mean, if the win state in The Sims was to get a fancy house, you're not going to spend a lot of time falling in love, getting married, and raising a family, as those things take time and money away from the goal of the game. Win states also tend to reduce a player's willingness to experiment or express themselves. When there's a clear goal, players look for optimal strategies, manage risk, and begin min-maxing their stats regardless of any other consideration. This is why a lot of games don't want to have win states. They want players to experiment with the system as much as possible. Minecraft, or at least before the Ender Dragon, The Sims, Dwarf Fortress, and other games are more about letting the player express themselves and define what the system means to them. By the way, all of this stuff goes for lose states too, but there are two key differences. The first, obviously, is that a lose state is a system state the player wants to avoid instead of achieve. The second is that while lose states push players away from certain playstyles, they don't really decree what the playstyle should be. Win states say, push the state of the game here and you win, while lose states say, push the game wherever you want, just not here. Dwarf Fortress is a good example of this. Without a win state, it doesn't really care what sort of fortress you build, but whatever you do, don't let your dwarves die or it's game over. Having a lose state without a win state is a great way to push players in a direction without having overt min-maxing or forsaking player expression. So generally speaking, that's the why and how of a win state, to shape play and drive players towards one or more goals. And all of this is more or less common sense, but I also like to look at two key properties I tend to ascribe to win states. They seem like an arbitrary ontology at first, but bear with me, because I think both properties are useful to understand. The first is a notion of Boolean versus non-Boolean win states. Boolean win states are win states that are discrete and absolute. You solved the puzzle, you killed all the terrorists on the enemy team, or you reached Bandage Girl. Boolean win states provide a single concrete goal to chase after, and that's their strength as a mechanic, to set a clear benchmark for player achievement. You either did it or you didn't. Stuff like finally getting Veni Vidi Vici is a clear example of this. On the flip side, non-Boolean win states are win states that aren't so much discrete win-lose, but more of a how much did you win or lose sort of a thing. The standard example of this concept is high scores. The point of games like Pac-Man or Waves here is to get the highest score you can, and those high scores function as a win state, contextualizing and shaping play the same way a Boolean win state would. Non-Boolean win states sacrifice the notion of an absolute victory in favor of a gradient that can be used to judge things like skill or speed. They don't ask the question, did you do it, but instead ask the player, how fast can you do it, or how skilled can you be while you do it. As a result, the feedback is more ambiguous without the greater context of a leaderboard, but it provides a way of measuring improvement and comparable success in a way that beating a Boolean win state doesn't really provide. While these two concepts might seem like opposites, they actually go really well together. Levels in Super Meat Boy have a primary Boolean win state of reaching Bandage Girl or getting the A+ score, but they also have the non-Boolean win state of your completion time. Spelunky, on the other hand, focuses on the non-Boolean win state of your score, but does in fact have a proper Boolean win state in the form of an end boss. The other attribute I like to think about is whether a win state is explicit or implicit, and this one's a little more controversial since one of them basically is not real, or at least not formal. So, explicit win states are game states that are officially recognized by the game systems as winning the game. For example, being the first to complete the spaceship in Civilization, or completing the mission objectives given to you in Osmos, or getting the other player into a checkmate in chess. These are formal win states that the system and the player agree upon and recognize as winning the game. Implicit win states are more subtle, and you can debate whether they really exist or more of a trick of the designer. They're not states the game expressly recognizes as winning, but for one reason or another, the player views them as good states to achieve given the implication of the game's design, metaphor, and story. For example, you don't win Skyrim by completing the main questline, and you don't beat Grand Theft Auto by capping off the last mission. But players see a narrative arc presented to them in the opening of the game that needs to be closed, and they feel compelled to push their play in that direction. It's not as intense as an explicit win state, and that's because arguably it isn't a real win state. But the game implies you should do this, and so the inkling is there. Alternately, let's go back to The Sims. In the game, money you earn grants power. You can buy more, better stuff that often lets you do entirely new things with your Sims, and you can gain access to fancier building materials for your house. While the game isn't ostensibly about earning lots of money, the fact that the system opens up to players with higher revenue streams implies that earning money is a desirable goal. This is compounded with the metaphor they're using. Cash is something we all want more of, and consequently it's seen as a good thing in the game space as well. The result is that the game pushes players to strive for promotions or activities that generate more cash flow for their Sims, even though the game never formally acknowledges making money as any sort of a win state. Think of implicit win states as gentle nudges in a given direction provided by content rewards, story framing, mechanic design, or the metaphor you choose to wrap the mechanics in. They still help contextualize and give meaning to play, but in a less extreme way than the explicit win states do. So that's my take on win states and lose states in a nutshell. Hopefully thinking of win states as a way to give meaning, context, and direction to play helps you examine your game's goals and how they impact minute-to-minute gameplay. If nothing else, try to use them in neat ways, to subvert player expectations, to juxtapose two competing win states, to frame a lose state and a win state so close to one another that chasing the win state is actually more dangerous than just exploring the core mechanics, or any other number of neat ways to contextualize play. Till next time.
Connection lost. Game over.